Good morning. Welcome to Northknot. Thanks for being here on this third Sunday of Advent. Just a couple of things for you to know moving forward into the day. First, another reminder to you about what's happening at the end of Advent, Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, just reminders. First, Christmas Eve will be here at 3 p.m. on Christmas Eve, which is a Saturday. That gets you home before it's terribly dark. And you may have other plans, and so the idea is to have you here at 3 p.m., and so know that that is true. The service will be relatively traditional. I know that saying something like traditional after 2 years or 3 years of COVID is a little odd, but that will be the service for Christmas Eve, and so we would love to have you. Second, Christmas Day, just as a reminder, it's Sunday. It's a 3:19 service, and so what we'll be doing is we will not be here on Christmas Day. We will be at Wexford Community Presbyterian, and all of us, Highland and Northmont and Wexford, will be having one service all together, and we just decided to have it at Wexford because why not? And so that will actually be at 10:30. That will be at 10:30 on Christmas Day at Wexford, and it's very, very casual, so please come dressed casually. I think we have a few other announcements, but I think that's all that I had, and so I wanted to pivot to my colleague who's hiding behind Jan Beatty. She's going to come up on here, and she's now well. My friend here has had the flu, as my household did, and so she's back. She's wily and spry, and she's ready to go.
Good morning. So this Wednesday, we're not doing Advent Adventures. So 3:19 is having a Christmas party at 6 p.m., and that will be at Highland Presbyterian. So don't come here on Wednesday. But the week after that will be another Advent Adventure at 5:30 here. So come to that. Don't miss that one.
Thank you. I think that's all I have. What do you have? He's approaching.
You've seen the signs this morning. They're up for the first time, and they've been in the Piper, but I just want to officially announce that file in your brain for the post-Christmas season. On January 8, we will be celebrating a service of lessons and carols here at 3 in the afternoon, dealing a lot with Christ being the light of the world and taking the light out to the nations. It will be candlelight and Christmas music for sure, and a nice way to wrap up one season and begin the next. So I hope you will plan to attend that service at 3 that day. There will be a regular church service at 10 in the morning, but this is a special event. We hope you can make it. Thank you.
Thank you all. Anything else? Anybody else? Yes, Robin McMillan. Dr. McMillan, please.
Yeah, just a quick reminder from the deacons. We're planning to add our poinsettia donations to the sanctuary next Sunday. So if you feel so moved and you would like to bring a poinsettia to share and beautify the sanctuary for Christmas Eve, that would be next Sunday, the 18th.
Excellent. Okay. Anything else? Now, as I try to twice a year, so if you, after the service, think to yourself, you know, I heard that sermon from today, and it was great. I just wish that there was more of it. I wish that there was two sermons today. I will be at Sherwood Oaks this afternoon, and so you can come and hear me again. And it'll be a different sermon, completely different sermon, never heard by ears. So you'll think to yourself, boy, this is maybe the best day of my life. This is a true joy. This is Pink personified. Okay, I'm done. Let us worship together. I'm done.
I look from afar, and lo, I see the
If you are able, please stand and join me for the call to worship. And now, in this place and among your people gathered, O come, Emmanuel. Into this busy place that we call home, O come, Emmanuel. Into this fragile group of your people, O come, Emmanuel. Into hearts and minds that search for the joy only your love can render. O come, Emmanuel. Come, let us worship God.
Oh.
for the third Sunday in Advent is joy. And now a reading from Psalm 98, verses 4 through 6. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody. With trumpets and the sound of the horn, make a joyful noise before the King, the Lord. Even in seasons of waiting, and especially moments of darkness, we must hold firm and celebrate the joy that is God's gift to us. And so, as we reflect upon the third candle for Advent, we do so mindful of the light of God's eternal presence. Today, in the spirit of joy, we pray the Spirit might show us new ways to experience the fullness of God. Let us pray. Dear Lord, as we continue our Advent pilgrimage, may we be filled with joy in every circumstance. For whatever we face, we do so with your love and strength as our firm foundation. This we ask in Christ's name. Amen. And now for the call to confession. Of course, we are not pleased to find ourselves once again in need of mercy, but we shall certainly go before God, anticipating the joy that comes from God's forgiveness. Let us do so now, first together, and then silently. Please join me in the prayer of confession. God of comfort and joy, sustain us and renew us. In those moments and in which we think less than we should of your creation, your people, and ourselves, forgive us. When we ignore or deny our part in what was broken, forgive us. Open our minds to your wisdom and truth, that we might walk in your ways. This we ask in Christ's name. Amen. As far as the east is from the west, so far shall God separate our transgressions from us. Forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. So some of you may have seen the title for today's sermon and you thought, oh, I'm going to get a lot of good Johnny Cash analogies for today. You were hoping for it. I don't know that I have it. I know, I'm sorry. I'm mentioning it right now. I'm mentioning it. This is what you get today. I'm sorry. I'm a huge Johnny Cash fan, but I was like, I looked at the passage and I looked at it and I looked at it and I couldn't shoehorn it in. But here's the reason why the title is what it is. Because we're doing a piece of scripture, we're talking about a piece of scripture that really couldn't be more exciting. I mean, whenever you think about scripture and you think about the great stories, I know that the first thing you think of is genealogies. I mean, these kids over here came because they heard that I was not only going to trip right there, but also that I'd be talking about genealogies today. And you're like, yeah, we totally know what that is. Thanks. Okay, so basically, it's a list of your ancestors. Yeah, it's really, it's amazing. And so we're walking that line. Okay, you get where I'm going with this. Not because you're mine. We're just going to walk it anyway. And so one of the things that is the challenge, of course, is how do I make sure that genealogies and Advent and joy and all of those things somehow come alive for you today? That's going to be an amazing little adventure we all go on together. But one of the things I want to make sure that you're thinking through and aware of as we go is that it's always important for us to have some sort of understanding of where we've been. And there isn't any time of year that I think that, besides maybe All Saints Day, where we think about that more than this time of year. As we're approaching Christmas, we think about our family story. If you're like me, you end up, you put the tree up and you go through the ornaments. And if you're the kind of person that has ornaments that are like intentional that you got every year, they're always attached with a memory. Like maybe you inherited that ornament, or maybe you got it when so-and-so was little or what have you, right? And we can kind of name them every year and, oh, you were doing this at this time, all that kind of stuff. This is a time of year that we do that. And so I think that's part of the power of this story for this morning, is how we attach and how we understand where we've been and how that gets us to where we are. And my goal, of course, is to bring some of that alive for us. And so as we're walking that line, or walking through a ring of fire, that's as close as I can get. Okay. I hope you do so with intentionality, remembering where we have been and where we're going. Let us pray. God, we thank you so much today for all the ways that you lift us up. We thank you for how you give us such a firm foundation in our past, and how as we move forward in this season, we do so with joy and anticipation for what you will continue to do in our lives. We pray all of these things in Christ's name. Amen.
The first scripture reading today is Ruth from the Old Testament, page 244, if you'd like to read along with me here, chapter 4, verse 13 through 22. As I was preparing to assist with the service today, I looked up the reading and noticed that it was Ruth. And the first thought that came to my mind was, oh, wow, a woman where there's a book of the Bible named after her. This must be important. That's what came to me, because there's not too many of those. And just a little explanation, as Ben said, this is about the genealogy of David and ultimately the family that Jesus was born into. And a little clarification, talking about two women in this book, Naomi and Ruth. And Naomi is Ruth's mother-in-law. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. When they came together, the Lord made her conceive, and she bore a son. Then the women said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord, who has not left you this day without next of kin. And may his name be renowned in Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons, has borne him." Then Naomi took the child and laid him in her bosom and became his nurse. The women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, "A son has been born to Naomi." They named him Obed. He became the father of Jesse, the father of David. Now these are the descendants of Perez. Perez became the father of Hezron, Hezron of Ram, Ram of Amminadab, Amminadab of Nahshon, Nahshon of Salmon, Salmon of Boaz, Boaz of Obed, Obed of Jesse, and Jesse of David. Thanks be to God.
Not to be outdone by the doctor to my left, but I too have many names to go through. I don't know that I have as good a handle on them yet as you did, but we will do our best. Our second reading for this morning comes to us from Matthew chapter 1, verses 1 through 6 and 17. Here again, God's word, the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah. An account of the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, and Judah the father of Perez, and Zerah by Tamar, and Perez the father of Hezron, and Hezron the father of Aram, and Aram the father of Amminadab, and Amminadab, the father of Nahshon, and Nahshon, the father of Salmon, and Salmon, the father of Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz, the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed, the father of Jesse, and Jesse, the father of David. And David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah. And so all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations, and from David to the deportation to Babylon, 14 generations, and from the deportation to Babylon to the Messiah, 14 generations. My friends, these two are God's words for us this morning. Thanks be to God. So I'd like to start off today by telling you a story. This story is of four women all doing their best to make it in the world as they knew it. The first woman's name we'll call Tammy, and she was married to the eldest of three brothers. Her husband died before they could have any children, and so, as was the custom in their country, the woman was expected to marry the man's brother. So he married the man's brother, who unfortunately also died. The third brother was too young to get married yet, and so her father-in-law promised that the family would allow her to marry him as soon as he was ready. Unfortunately, the family did not keep up their part of the bargain. So Tammy was put into an extremely vulnerable position. So Tammy came up with a plan. Knowing that her father-in-law was going out of town, she dressed up like an escort and covered her face and sat beside a road to wait for him. In exchange for services rendered, Tammy held onto his staff and his ring to guarantee that he would come through with the promise of compensation that would come later. So he tried sending and settling the amount with the woman, but she could not be found anywhere. Later, Tammy became pregnant, and when her father-in-law found out, he was furious. But before the traditional punishment could be executed, Tammy was able to prove that the child was conceived with her father-in-law by producing the aforementioned staff and ring that she had taken from him when in disguise and held on to. Suddenly, the father declared Tammy to be righteous and was more than happy to fulfill the family's obligation. And so Tammy married the third brother, securing safety and security for both herself and her child. The second woman in our story is named Ray. Ray lived in a city that was about to be conquered by a foreign army. The leader of that army sent two spies ahead of the siege. Ray saved the spies when their lives were threatened by her own people. And in return, they promised that she would be spared whenever the city eventually fell. Ray's professional background was the same as our friend Tammy's. The invading people worshipped a god that she did not know, but over time, she developed a strong and devoted faith. And in the end, it was this faith that led her to work against her own people in order to help secure the victory for the invading forces. The third woman's name is Ruthie. She and her mother-in-law found themselves widowed and alone after the death of their husbands. Proving that you actually can go home again, the two of them settled in the mother-in-law's hometown. Ruthie, a resourceful, hard-working type, strikes up a relationship with one of the patriarchs in the family, marries him, and then they have a child together. And much like our friend Tammy, she finds a way to secure safety and security for not only herself, but for all of those that she loves. The final woman in this story is named Beth. She was married to a soldier who was off at war. And in the meantime, she caught the eye of the king. One thing led to another, and the king saw to it that Beth's husband would soon meet his demise on the front lines. And after the husband's passing, the king marries Beth, who would later give birth to a great prince. All of these women, coming from different backgrounds and circumstances, all found a way to survive. The cultures and systems that they were a part of did not always care for people like them, But they did not allow that to stop them from doing what was needed in order to keep going. Their names and their stories are worth remembering, especially for anyone who may feel left out, who may feel abandoned or abused by the powers that be. And it's for this reason, I believe, that these four women find themselves listed in the genealogy of Christ. Cue the music. Tamar, aka Tammy, is named in verse 3, and her story can be found in Genesis 38. Rahab, aka Ray, you can't hear the music, but I can. Rahab, aka Ray, is named in verse 5, and her story can be found in Joshua 2. Ruthie, aka Ruth, has her own book, of course. And Bathsheba, aka Beth, goes unnamed in this list that we saw for this morning, but is referred to in verse 6 as the wife of Uriah. And her story can be found in 2 Samuel 11. I assume that she, Bathsheba, goes unnamed in this story because her relationship with David is so shameful for David. And since the genealogy here is really all about connecting King David to Jesus, maybe Matthew just felt like alluding to her was enough. Now, I don't know what you all thought you might be getting whenever you saw this text. You heard that this is what we were doing. You read the text for the week. Maybe you were involved in my first look thing I do online. But whenever you hear about a genealogy, I'm sure that breathless with anticipation is not the thing that first comes to your mind and heart. But this goofy list of names accomplishes for us two amazing things. While setting the stage for the fact that this poor kid from Nazareth was about to change the world. And so let's dive into it. A genealogy, if you think about it, is a roadmap. It's used in Scripture to allow the reader to connect the dots. And a lot of it, what we've been doing in this series I've been up to over the last few weeks has been about connecting dots. It gives us background and context, and it connects what is to what has been. And the first thing that this particular genealogy establishes is a legitimate path for Jesus to be the Messiah. Given the fact that Jesus didn't look or act like any image that the people would have in their minds of what a Messiah would look like, this was a pretty important thing for them to establish. Because the people were looking for this warrior king. They were looking for this geopolitical liberator that they had seen written about in books like Daniel. Someone who would be a savior in that kind of grandiose war kind of way, and that obviously was not the Jesus vibe. The Matthew audience is mostly a Jewish audience, and so connecting the current prophetic figure not only to King David, but to the very founders of the faith would have been extremely convincing for those who were reading this originally. If one was going to dare to follow this Jesus, as he colored so far outside the lines of what people were used to, it would have been comforting to at least have a picture of who he was and where he came from. So legitimacy is the first reason that we see this list as it's shown. And the second reason we see this list is because of the story that it has to tell. And only part of that story is the one that I paraphrased for us just a little bit ago. Which is why I began this sermon for this morning with a little bit more information than we would normally have about all the unique individuals that we find that go named in this list. Because their inclusion not only says a lot about Jesus himself, the fact that I was able to rattle off those four women in that story the way that I was, their inclusion not only says a lot about who Jesus is, but it also says a lot about who the author of this book is. Okay? So not only does it give us a reflection on Jesus, but also a reflection on Matthew. Because he chooses the order of the ancestors very intentionally, and also with tremendous boldness. Given what you and I know about Jesus, we shouldn't be surprised that we see four women mentioned in this genealogy, even though the inclusion of female ancestors in one's genealogy was certainly not the norm. First, we have discussed the kind of impact that we can assume that Mary had on Jesus. We know that whenever we think about Jesus' past and we think about influences, if you remember the series that we did last year, we know how much of an impact Mary and her thoughts about the world must have impacted who Jesus was. Because Mary sang this song. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away. That was the theology of Mary, and Jesus included women among his disciples as well, I think in large part because of the influence of Mary in his life. And we know that Jesus included women in his disciples because it tells us that in Luke 8. We know that Jesus reached out to and advocated for those who were not born of the tribes of Israel as well. So we know that Jesus is not only concerned with the lives of women, but also with those who were among the Gentiles. Because Gentiles are also included in this list, hence Ruth. You and I know that about him, but Matthew wanted to make sure that those reading it for the first time never forgot it, and so he wrote it down. Who I think this genealogy says the most about, I think, is the author of the book itself. Because we know all those things about Jesus already, and so what do we know about the person of Matthew? Especially because Matthew, in some ways, represents his audience. So if we know something about Matthew, we know something about the people that he was talking to. To include non-traditional voices in this ancestral choir meant that the people would experience notes that they would not otherwise have resonated with them. And at first glance, what we get here is a class of sinners and saints. But Matthew's ultimate point is much bigger than that. These four women, along with the dozens of men who are listed, could not and should not be defined by their shortcomings, as is true for you and for me. But instead, they represent the work of God that is visible within all of us. Tamar, Rahab, and Ruth, and Bathsheba were survivors, if nothing else. They struggled through the rigors of life and overcame heartache and danger in order to secure safety for themselves and for those that they loved. And in that way, they represented the people of Israel as well as anyone could. But they were also perfect examples of the imperfect saints that Christ had come to champion, just like all of us. You and I need as many reminders of God's unrelenting and all-reaching love as we can get our hands on, which is exactly what this passage for today does, even if it takes a little bit of digging to find it. Because if you just read the genealogy, it's just a bunch of names. It's just people that maybe you've heard of or maybe you've forgotten. But when we stop and pause and come back just a little bit and spend a little bit more time thinking about their stories as stories that could relate to all of you or could relate to someone that you know, they become more alive in our hearts and minds, and they affect the way that we understand what love and joy can look like. You and I need every ounce of joy that we can muster, especially when everything around us can feel bleak and cold. We need inspirational figures of faith who teach us what it means to persevere in the face of systems and situations that might otherwise take us down. We need voices that speak for the voiceless so that their stories might never be forgotten. And I am thankful today for those voices and for the stories that they have to share with us. And so my prayer for us this morning is that we would sit with the idea that God is telling us a story that sometimes we overlook. And sometimes that God is providing for us strength and compassion that sometimes we do not see within ourselves, because we overlook it for something else, something easier. So may you and I, this morning, as we think about their stories and we think about our own, may we always be those who find the way to endure together. And may Christ's glorious legacy inspire each and every step ahead. May it be true for you and for me. And to God be the glory this day and forevermore. Amen. It's truly a blessing to be able to pray together. during the week, if you're anything like me, the things that you go through feel like so isolated and could sometimes feel very alone. And to be able to go into a place where there is a community formed around the idea of ensuring that we do not carry those burdens by ourselves is an amazing thing. It says something about the way that we see the way that the world should be. And so we do that now together, joys, concerns, and everything in between. What are we praying for this morning? Yes. I didn't know that. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. I will have to I'll post it online. If you're that hungry for it, you're hungry for the word, I will certainly provide. But thank you, Reverend, for reminding us of that. I didn't know that about the COVID rule. Thank you. Yes. For Kevin, who has suffered a setback in his cancer treatments. Other things. Yes, Gwen. For Bob, who's on the prayer chain, whose health has taken a turn for the worse. Okay. Thank you. Jane. A joy. Yay, for Logan, who was born yesterday. How many grandchildren are you up to now? Two. I knew it was multiple, but I couldn't remember. Okay. Wonderful. Yes, sir. For the passing of Joe Kegler. Yes. Okay. Got it. I knew it was familiar. Okay. 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 I'm making all the connections now. Okay. Yep. Thank you. Yes. I'm sorry, for the passing of whom? Dan Rigner, a neighbor of yours? Thank you. And a successful heart surgery for Finley, who I know that we've been praying for. Yes, thank you for reminding us and giving us an update. That's fantastic. For Dave, who's starting a new phase of cancer treatments. Thank you. Yes.
For the Anderson family, Larry lost his mother Barbara last week, so
do you know if they're still in Maine?
I think they're coming back.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. That's for Larry Anderson's mother Barbara passed away.
Yeah. It's a barrier, but the joy that everybody receives.
I'm going to do the best to translate all of that. I appreciate that. So what Jody is praying for is just the fact that, one, in the COVID world that we've been living through, one, that we get to be here in person, and second, that the music of the season, not only from our wonderful choir, but from wonderful choirs all around, some of them adult choirs, some of those little itty-bitty choirs, some of them in schools and other places, for all of the things that we get to enjoy because of the season and because of the efforts of those who make them happen, we certainly are thankful. Yes?
For Jack and Sue Swick, who have COVID.
For Jack and Sue Swick, who do have COVID, yes. Okay. For Fred, a friend of Stephen's who has blood cancer and from the recovery from a fall as well. Other things. Let's go before God together. Holy and gracious God, we go before you this morning with a mountain of concern for those that we love. We also go before you with joy and expectation and hope for those people who are around us, who remind us of your goodness. We are doing our best in this season, as are the people that they love, to put one foot in front of the other. And it's a good reminder, especially when we are speaking of joy, to be able to recognize the hardship that it takes to keep that within us. Joy is not a temporary emotion, but something that is sort of a flame that stays within us. That reminds us that we can indeed lean on each other. That reminds us that compassion is all around us. That gives us the strength and endurance to do the next best thing. And so we thank you this morning for that still small presence of joy that ignites within us a sense of wonder and gratitude for the days that you have given to us. And so we pray in this season for as much of it as we can muster. We pray in this season for those that we have mentioned here this morning, for our families, for our neighbors, for our loved ones, for our friends, and for those across the world that are sometimes opposed to us. We pray this morning that you would continue to light our way, that you would give us hope and peace. And we can only pray all of these things and do all of these things because of who your Son has been and is and will always be. And so we pray now the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, if you are able, if you will please stand with me as we affirm our faith together this morning using a portion of a brief statement of faith. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of people long silenced, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, Come, Lord Jesus. Please be seated. As we pray this morning for our tithes and offerings, things to remind you of. First, our plate is at the door to my right and most of your left, right outside the door, so you can find that there. Also, if you are worshiping with us at home or elsewhere, know that there are electronic ways of giving and also, of course, through the mail. Ask us and we will help if we can. Let us pray together. God, we ask for your continued strength and wisdom as we seek to do your will in this place. We thank you for all that has been given to us, and we ask that you would continue to inspire us. Allow us to see your world through your eyes. Allow us to see others as you would see them. Give us endurance this day, that we might walk your path of faith. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. things before I give you the benediction. First, please join us for fellowship time downstairs. Second, Stephen Minister Jody Seven, who is right there, is available to you for prayer or for just listening if you need an ear this morning. And Gwen, sparring with darkness, is our Stephen Minister for the week, who will be doing wellness calls. And so if you need to pass along anything, please do so with her. I think that one of the things that we overlook, of course, is that this is a trying time. These months tend to sort of reflect the weather outside in many ways, which is what makes what we do here so powerful. The candles that we light, the songs that we sing, the ways that we talk about who God is are powerful reflections of the way that we see the world and the ways that we interact with it. For we are those who bring joy into it through our compassion and for our love for the other, especially those who would not otherwise have a voice. We see in this story for this morning reminders of who Christ is and reminders of the people that he was there to minister to at that time and in this time. We are those who reflect God's all-encompassing love, and we do so with that compassion and that strength in our hearts. But thankfully, as we do so, we do not do these things alone. Who we go forward into those dark moments with all of the joy and peace and hope that only the one who creates us and redeems us and sustains us can provide. Amen.